The European Patent Office podcasts bring you an insight into the technology and innovation shaping the world.
Hello, and welcome to this podcast from the European Patent Office, in which we will be discussing the Unitary Patent. It's the cheaper and simpler way to enjoy European patent protection, and uptake in its first year has been higher than expected, which is great. But who is using the system, and why? And how could it help a technology business, large or small? We'll be answering these questions today, and we'll also be sharing some breaking news, so stay tuned. My name is Jeremy Philpott, and I work in communication at the European Patent Office. Joining me today is European patent attorney, Dr. Marek Bury. Marek is a partner at Bury & Bury in Warsaw. He has a master's in IT, automation and robotics, a PhD in microwave imaging, and a master's in law since 2017. Marek takes special interest in software patents and co-chairs the Information and Communication Technologies Group of the European Patent Institute. Welcome, Marek.
Hello, Jeremy. Thank you for this kind introduction and for the invitation. I'm very happy to be here and discuss with you a topic that I've been interested in for a while.
It's good to have you with us, Marek, and I've been following some of the things you've been saying about the Unitary Patent on LinkedIn, so I know you're a keen observer of what's going on. Just from my point of view, and to set a little bit of context, we see that the Unitary Patent is the completion of the vision of the founders of the EPO, going back to the 1970s and before, that they wanted a patent system that was easier to use, that dealt with national fragmentation and the cost and complexity of individual national rights that was interfering with having a single Europe for technologies. And in the 70s, they could deal with most of the issues about, you know, how applications should be filed, under what rules and regulation. But the things that they couldn't resolve were the two key questions of what court was competent to hear a dispute and what language a patent should be in. And that gave rise to the fragmented system that the EPO has worked with for its first 50 years. But now, finally, the vision of the founders for creating a single environment for patents in Europe and this single unified court as finally being realized. So the Unitary Patent is the completion of that vision. And we're really pleased with the amount of demand. We've seen 28,000 requests for Unitary Effect in the first 12 months of the system. And we've registered 27,500 Unitary Patents. So for us at the EPO, we're exceeding our expectations for uptake rate, and especially amongst the SMEs.
Well, it was still short of my expectations.
Oh. Okay, you hoped for more, did you, Marek?
Well, the system was intended to replace the classic validation system entirely. So I sort of had that base value or reference value of 100% at the back of my head.
Yeah, but to be fair, Rome wasn't built in a day, and the authors of the Unitary Patent did foresee transitional arrangements lasting 7 years. So I think they were expecting it might take just a little bit more time for the UP to get adopted.
Well, for sure, even then, it is not going to replace the classic EP validations entirely, as a couple of countries that are member states of the European Patent Convention are outside the system and cannot easily join. I mean, United Kingdom, Switzerland, Norway, Turkey, those are the countries that have no easy way to join. And also there is a couple of countries that can join, but still are a little bit reluctant and probably have their reason.
Yeah, it's true. There are some fairly key markets which currently are sitting outside the Unitary Patent. I'm ever the optimist, and I remember that 8 or 9 years ago, Italy, major market, was outside the system, but they've subsequently signed on. And by the time the system started 12 months ago, Italy was on board and a central player. So I hope, I'm prepared to play the long game. Let's see how many more countries come along in the future.
At the moment, it seems that the system does not cover most typical way the patent proprietor used to validate in Europe. The first way was just the three biggest and easiest country, Germany, France, and United Kingdom. The second way was more difficult, and except for the first three, there was also Italy and Spain. My clients, on the other hand, are predominantly based in Poland, so for them, it was usually Germany, France, and UK. and national validation in Poland. So of those paths, and the three paths I've mentioned that are quite typical, at least among my clients, the unitary patent still does not resolve all the issues with translations and with the renewal payments.
Okay, but on the topic of translations, that when you're talking to your clients, is translation costs one of the things that they're focused on or worried about? Is that one of the draws to the unitary patent system for them?
Well, that's not the first issue I discussed with them when discussing whether they should go the classic validation way or for the unitary patent. In the scheme that we have just discussed, I mean, Germany, France, and the United Kingdom, and national validation in Poland, actually, for my client, translation costs are pretty much the same, because we either have the Polish text of the patent since the beginning, and it only needs to be amended, and therefore it is reusable for the Polish validation and for the request for unitary effect. UK is outside the system, and the burden of France and Germany is not that high. So the translation costs are not the main factor here. The main factor here is larger geographical scope of protection for pretty much the same money. So it's about keeping the option open for expanding to other markets.
Okay, then I'll go to a related point then, looking at how to optimize or maximize market protection. Is that one of the things that when you're dealing with your clients who are, say, university spin-outs or startups, and knowing that you're trying to get them in a fit position to be able to impress investors, is that one of the things that then investors are going to be looking for?
Well, investors, as far as I can learn, are not always very much aware of the patent systems. They know that the companies they invest in need to have patent protection, and that's an important factor. But what they exactly expect from the patent protection is not always that clear, and also their expectation quite often contradict each other. It seems as if a lot of investors had a list of checkboxes to obtain, and it seems that the first box is to have the patent application filed and have reasonable chances to obtain the patent, preferably even have the patent being granted, but simultaneously they would like to have their options open. And also, they would like to have it fast and at small cost. So that's, of course, the set of requirements that is impossible to meet, and we can only offer subsets. Nevertheless, a major problem is related to initial costs, cost of drafting the patent applications, and official costs of prosecution, especially in multiple jurisdictions. That is why a lot of my startup clients postpone the major costs via PCT procedure. Nevertheless, they are hardly ever worried very much about the possible renewal cost, especially they are not worried about the renewal cost at the time they decide whether to file or not. So when they plan the patent procedure, they sort of look for just a couple of years, like first 2 years or first 3 years. They definitely don't calculate all 20 years of patent protection compared with the Excel data of the unitary patent renewals and the renewals in particular member states. They tend to forget that having patent granted is not enough and that there are certain business decisions to make within quite a short time afterwards.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, for most startups, they're struggling to see how they might survive until the end of next month. So trying to get them to have a vision for where they might want their granted patent validated in 4 or 5 years is obviously going to be quite difficult. You also talked about investors and their checkboxes. And yeah, it's a rather reductive way of approaching the patent system if it's just a box ticking exercise. And certainly for investors who are just focused on, you know, does this startup have a granted patent or not, can lead to a startup rushing to grant and inadvertently narrowing some of their options for the future, because that's what the investor wants, when actually it would have been in their interest to have played a longer game and kept more options open for later by not rushing for grant. So I want to sort of move on to a related question then, Marek. Do you think more could be done to help investors understand the unitary patent?
Well, I think that first thing is informing them. And also, I'm not sure how much understanding do they need at the time they decide for investment. And later on, it's hardly their decision to make whether the patent is going to be unitary or not. I think that EPO campaigns are quite nice in this respect.
Oh, thank you.
Perhaps it would be worth noting that what investors are trying to find and what they are looking for are the unicorns, the companies that are going to have enormous growth and that prove to have a really good product that is going to be sold everywhere and in vast amounts. And of course, if that highly positive and very rare scenario happens, it is so rare that it is called the unicorn, then it is nice to have a patent protection that has a huge geographical scope and, of course, broad scope of protection of the patent claims. So perhaps noting the relation of large geographical scope of protection with the success of the unicorn is something that may deserve more attention of the investors.
On the mention of unicorns, I can't resist mentioning something else that's a little bit off topic, but I think still fits here. The EPO recently launched a new online tool called the Deep Tech Finder, which links the business profiles of these European startups with their patent portfolios. So at a glance, you can see how much venture capital or other investment a startup has attracted, and then also see what patent applications or granted patents that they've got. We're hoping that this helps investors find their next unicorn. And of course, that blended with whether or not those granted patents have got unitary effect is even more helpful.
Yeah, I've seen it. That seems to be a great tool. Actually, I wasn't that happy about it because it sort of takes daily bread away from the patent attorneys who should be required to do the due diligence.
I'm sorry, Marek. I'm sorry. I'll take the spontaneous endorsement there. We're pretty proud of the Deep Tech Finder, and we've got more features in the pipeline that we'll be adding to it in the coming months. So, Marek, before we go any further, I'd just like to salute you as a fellow number-crunching nerd. I see what you post on LinkedIn. I think it's every Wednesday when the bulletin comes out. You crunch your own data and make your own analysis on EP grants and unitary patent uptake.
Oh, thank you very much for noticing. Indeed, I use the EPO systems to count the granted patents and registered unitary effects, as well as the opt-outs and opt-ins. And I try to see what are the relations between the numbers. That is why I know that in 2024, the fraction of unitary effects of European patents is circa 23%.
Yeah. Okay, well, I can totally understand why you do this. I crunch EPO data all the time. I work on the patent index, and I work closely with the team who run the unitary patent dashboard on our website where we publish our statistics that are updated daily.
Oh, may I compliment your statistic page? It's quite nice.
Oh, thank you very much. That's very kind. I just wanted to touch on another aspect about startups. Do you see that there are other reasons why startups might use the patent system? I've talked about attracting investment, maybe because they need to litigate or not. Do you see other uses for patents for startups?
Well, patent ownership is also an important tool to deter departing employees, including any departing founder or founders, from setting up a rival company based on the same technology. And this is why the patents are so important for the investors. It is not only some external competitors the investor should be worried about. It is also the relation with startup founders and startup employees. It is worth noting that patent protection checkbox is very high on the investors' checklist. As far as I learned from my clients, the first question of the investor is about the product, the second is about the team, the third one is about IP protection, especially patent protection. And it seems a very, very high priority for securing oneself against such an unlikely event like patent litigation. Only 1-2% of patents are ever enforced and litigated before court, and yet they are so important for the investors. And the reason, as I understand this situation, is that having a patent in the company keeps everyone behaving in an honest way. It makes it more risky and more difficult to leave the company and start another very similar competing one. So this is a glue for the relation between the founders and the investors.
Yeah. Very good. The glue between founders and investors. You remind me of a case in the UK about 20 years ago that was part of one of these entrepreneurs pitched their ideas to investors TV shows. The same format is in different countries under different names. In the UK, it was called Dragon's Den. And there was indeed, it was just this scenario you mentioned. It was the inventor of some cable ties. And he came on Dragon's Den wanting investment in his second company. And unfortunately, he'd already patented something very similar when he was in his first company. And the first company still owned that patent. And so they were in a position to then enforce against him for his slight improvement on the original invention for the cable tie. So, yeah. Yeah.
That's a nice example.
Yeah, absolutely concrete case. So yeah, indeed, patents keeping everybody honest and in a way sort of binding the founders to the company. Anyway, sorry for the aside. I want to turn now actually to the new court, the Unified Patent Court. From your discussions with your clients that you're advising, how are they responding to the idea of litigating through the Unified Patent Court?
You mean the UPC? UPC is a... Yes. An abbreviation that is safe for me because I tend to make a mistake and call the Unified Patent Court the Unitary Patent Court, which is of course wrong, but I cannot teach myself away from that.
That's okay. That's okay. Yeah, and you wouldn't be the first one either, Marek.
Well, it is very new, so the first understanding is that involves certain risks. And well, that was even built up by the suggestion that it might be reasonable to opt out part of the patent portfolio. It also was widely discussed in the profession that it is a safer way of managing patent portfolio vis-a-vis starting out the UPC, not to keep all the eggs in one basket. So that's the first understanding, that it might be risky. Well, and it also seems to be quite expensive, especially comparing to costs in one jurisdiction. Poland is one example of jurisdiction in which litigation is significantly less expensive when it comes to the official fees. And also, if the patent dispute is quite small, then it is sometimes easier to have it in the domestic language before the domestic courts. So that's another risk factor. On the other hand, if it happens that the patent dispute is a large one that covers a couple of jurisdictions and there is a number of proceedings that are run in parallel, then for such a dispute, Unified Patent Court might be a less expensive option.
Yeah, I think the calculation was done assuming that if you were going to be litigating in multiple jurisdictions, then the UPC works out as more cost effective. I suppose it also very much depends against which national courts you're making the comparison, because we know that some national courts are subsidized by the state and that therefore court fees are very, very low. And in other countries, the litigants are paying the full cost of what that court actually costs to run. And that's why litigations are more expensive in some countries than others. But I do appreciate that, you know, if you're only needing to sue in one country, then possibly suing through a single court might be more interesting. It also depends, I suppose, on how quickly you can get a judgment. And in that sense, because the UPC is advertising that they want to issue judgments within 12 months, even if in comparison with a particular national court, who knows which one, the UPC might be more expensive. If that cheaper national court is going to take many years to issue a decision, then maybe it's actually in your interest to accept what the UPC is going to cost you, because you're going to get clarity so much sooner. And that clarity itself and the speed of the judgment has a substantial value in itself. You know, there's a value that you can assign to that speed.
Well, if judgments are indeed issued in 12 months, then that might be perceived as a huge advantage of the Unified Patent Court, maybe even for some companies covering the increase of fees. I mean, increase comparing to the national jurisdictions, whether they are subsidized by the government or not. Nobody said that it is a fair competition. Anyway, the initial costs of starting the litigation with UPC are deterring for small or maybe even medium entities. I mean, the amount of money that needs to be put on the table and another amount even higher, the pile of money that need to be risked in that dispute, is a deterring factor for the smaller applicants. It might be a very, very expensive dispute and maybe even higher than the value of the company. So this is really a limiting factor.
Okay. Well, we do see some SMEs amongst the early litigants at the UPC. But you're right. I mean, the new court has been in operation now barely a year. So I guess we will be hoping in the coming weeks and months we start seeing the first few decisions. And I think maybe that's going to then address some of the concerns that some of the profession have about how the UPC arrives at its decisions. Is it making decisions which are broadly harmonious with existing case law? So we wait to see how that works out. I'd like to start to move towards the conclusion because it's been a great chat, but time is pressing on. What would you hope that the unitary patent system could offer in the future, Marek?
Well, I think that the system has certain limits that are not that easy to be passed, to be overcome. I think that key problem is related to the states that are outside the European Union, and those seem to be pretty important countries. I mean, UK is no small market. Switzerland is important for the patent protection in some technologies too. Norway, Turkey, those are quite important countries that are not likely to join. So yeah, I think that extending the scope of the countries is nice, but still there is a certain limit to what system can offer.
Well, I still draw comfort and confidence and hope from the example of Italy that was outside and is now inside. So who knows what we get?
Well, we shall see, but that is difficult, especially in certain fields of technology, like with pharmaceuticals, when UK and Switzerland are not actually optional geographical destinations of the patent.
Well, even without those other countries being on board at the moment, I still see that there's a broader benefit that the Unified Patent Court provides for all of the patent players in Europe, whether they're from a country inside the UP system or not at the moment. And that's the Unified Patent Court over time in the next few years is going to help develop a unified body of case law. And that will have, you know, spin-off benefits. It's going to inform the practices at the EPO. There's going to be a sort of mutually reinforcing effect between case law from the Boards of Appeal and case law from the UPC, hopefully leading to broader harmonization and interpretation everywhere. So I see that as a positive.
Yeah, I really hope for some sort of golden standard for claims interpretation, especially when it comes to the doctrine equivalence. It is so non-uniform right now, and it would be nice to have a body that has, well, maybe not a final say, but at least that can be put as a reference. But Jeremy, you have said that you have some breaking news to share.
Did I? Oh, yes, I quite forgot. And this actually, Marek, it goes back to your point about, you know, it's a pity that some countries are outside the system. We have a new member coming along. Breaking news just in, Romania is going to be joining. They just deposited their instrument of ratification for the UPC agreement, and they will be a member of the Unitary Patent family from the 1st of September. So there'll be 18 EU member states in the UP system.
Yeah, this means that we are going to have two types of unitary effects in the system, one covering 70 countries and the other covering 18 countries. That's going to make our professional life definitely more interesting.
Yes, you're right on both counts. Yes, it does now mean that unitary patents granted to date cover 17 countries. Those unitary patents which are registered after the 1st of September will cover 18 countries. And yes, Marek, it is going to make your life more interesting.
Well, joining the system from the perspective of a country that has a small annual amount of European patents being granted and European patent applications filed is not an easy one. I mean, it's not an easy decision to join. I do wonder what are political and economical incentives for such countries, because being close to the system, having own representatives in the system, but not being exposed to full competence of the Unified Patent Court has certain advantages. Also, there is an issue of the validation rate. I'm not sure how is it in Romania, but in Poland, the validation rate is circa 10%. It means that only one out of 10 granted European patent is valid, enforceable in Poland at present. So for Poland, it definitely would not be an easy decision to make.
Well, in the case of Romania, I'm looking at it at, you know, this is a country with 19 million consumers in it. Therefore, the value of the total market that a unitary patent will represent from the 1st of September just got 19 million consumers bigger. So I'm looking at this more about what does this bring to Europe as a whole rather than what does it bring to Romania individually. And as for Poland, I hope they do join the Unitary Patent family whenever they're able to. I think it would be, as it is for Romania, I think it will be good for Poland, and I think it will be good for Europe. But my goodness, all my alarm clocks are pinging, so we're definitely out of time. But thank you, Marek. It's been really enlightening to get your insights, and I've enjoyed our chat a lot. Thanks to all of you out there for listening. Check out the latest information on the Unitary patent, especially on our dashboard at epo.org/unitary. The EPO publishes fresh podcasts on new technologies, studies, and the economic impact of patents, as well as advice for innovators. So listen out for more podcasts soon. But for today, from Marek and myself, it's goodbye.
Do widzenia.
Goodbye, everyone. Bye-bye.
Subscribe to the European Patent Office's podcast channel, Talk Innovation, at epo.org or on your favorite podcast platform. Let's Talk Innovation.